Thursday at the museum program. I'm Sharon Harrow, Community Engagement Manager with the DIA. Thank you for joining us. As a reminder, general admission to the museum is always free for residents of Wayne, Oakland, and Macomb counties. So if you enjoy our program today, we hope you're encouraged to visit us in the museum. If you want to leave a comment today, you can do so by writing in the chat on YouTube and in the comment section on Facebook. Today, we're doing an informative walkthrough of Ofrendas celebrating the Day of the Dead with the DIA Family Program Coordinator and Ofrenda Curator, Emily Bauer, and artists from the exhibition. Enjoy.
Thanks, Sharon, and thanks to everyone who's here watching us. So the Ofrendas Celebrating El Dia de Muertos is an annual exhibition that we have at the DIA. This is actually the 10th annual, this is the 10th year that we've had it, and it features the work of community artists who do submissions to create altars or ofrendas in honor of lost loved ones or lost icons who have influenced the artists, or in general, kind of like more like groups of people who have been lost. And this celebrates the Mexican tradition of Day of the Dead. And the museum has been partnering with the Mexican consulate in Detroit, and also Mexican Town CDC and Southwest Detroit Business Association for the past several years to put this program on. And today we are going to be, I wanted to also let you know, it generally runs for 6 weeks, starting at the end of September and through to the first week of November, so that we are up during the Day of the Dead, November 1st and 2nd. And so there's one more week for this exhibition, so that we hope that you are able to come down and see it in person. And while the artists talk today, you'll also see the digital exhibition, which we have done for 3 years now. This will be the third time that the Ofrendas exhibition has been fully accessible online via Matterport, which is kind of similar to Google Maps experience. So while the artists are talking, you'll see that. And you can explore the exhibition on your own digitally at dia.org/ofrendas2022. But of course, we do hope that you come down in person. There are some elements that we can't share online. There's music in some of the pieces and video in some of the pieces. So it really does, it's a different experience when you're here. So we hope that you can come in person. So right now, I do want to introduce one of our partners, Marlon Lara Paras from the Mexican Consulate. And he will, hi, welcome.
Hi.
And he's going to be giving us just a brief kind of overview of the Day of the Dead and traditions for maybe some of us who are unfamiliar. So Marlon, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Yes, as Emily said, just beginning a brief presentation of some of the basics of how Day of the Dead came to be, starting in Mesoamerica, and how it's evolved into what it is today. First of all, the Day of the Dead, or Dia de Muertos, as it is known, is celebrated November 1st, in which we celebrate All Saints Day, and November 2nd, All Souls Day. Now, it's very important, we have to clear up some misconceptions. Day of the Dead is not a Mexican Halloween. Day of the Dead does not represent a scary holiday. It's not meant to spook or, you know, to be sinister or things like that. It's meant to honor and to show respect for our loved ones who have passed away. It's a joyous celebration. It's to remember them with peace and love in our hearts. And we do celebrate by painting ourselves as skulls or calaveritas, as we call them. Further on right now in the explanation, I will let you guys know that actually that's something that went along the way as this holiday was taking shape. And it's very important to also note that in 2008, UNESCO recognized the importance of Dia de Muertos by adding the holiday to its list of intangible cultural heritage of humanity. So for Mexico, this is very, very important. So now getting back to the origins, as I was saying, Mesoamerica times, they believed in different gods. So whatever happened to you in your life, whatever way you passed away, then that determined where you went in the afterlife. I can give a quick little example. You can think of like Thor and the warriors in when they passed away, they went to Valhalla. So they had, when warriors passed away, that's where they went to. The same went for the Mexicas or Aztecs and all these Mesoamerican cultures. So what is beyond for death for the ancient Mexicas, for example? So in Mesoamerica, before we had the influence of the conquistadors of the Catholic and Christian Church, however you lived and however you died, it depend where you went. So, you know, Mictlan, the kingdom of those who died of natural causes. So if you lived a long life in that time, 30, 40 years, you would pass away, then that's where you went. And that's who the people would pray to Dios Mictlan, because your loved one, that's how he passed away. You know, for example, we have Talocan, for those who died by drowning, you know, or lightning strike or disease, pretty much in their interpretation of that time, anybody that died due to the world. If there was a flood, if there was a fire, or a natural cause which caused somebody to pass away. And these are the thoughts and the beliefs that we had in Mesoamerica. And in order to fully indoctrinate people into Catholicism and Christianity, the conquistadors, they started to blend in some of the celebrations that were taking place in Mesoamerica and blending them with the new faith that they were installing and while they were, you know, in Mexico or in that part of the world. And here's a good example, for example, of syncretism, the two worlds, you know, the rivals of the Spaniards. And as you can see here, I have a quick little picture. This is a good example. These are ruins in Mexico City of an old temple. And then you see in the background are a very beautiful Palacio Nacional de Bellas Artes, which was built by the Spaniards to show their power, to show the Catholic power, and to pretty much get rid of a lot of the Mesoamerican culture that was already left there to begin with. And also very important to note that the original celebration was at the beginning of August to November. So whenever they were with the syncretism, they just decided to make this new celebration to celebrate all the loved ones who passed away, to make it the 1st of November and the 2nd. Now, that's pretty much the history, and then how it came to be, you know, very quickly, how after the conquistadors, they went in, installed Catholicism, and then the Day of the Dead came to be from that, from the previous Mesoamerican cultures of honoring your dead through various gods. And then modernly now we have the altar of the ofrenda, which is 100% derived from the Catholic Christian faith. And there's a lot of elements that are very important. And number one, I would say, is food. Food is by far one of the most important things in the ofrenda, because you set up an ofrenda for your loved ones, so their spirits come to visit you from, you know, from the beyond. You're waiting for them. And, you know, just like any good host, whenever you're going to have someone at your house, you have to be able to feed them. You have to have something to give them. And in this case, when you're making an altar, we set up food for our loved ones. So if I would set up one for my grandfather, he loved tequila, cheese, and crackers. That was like his late night snack. I would put some tequila, some cheese, and some crackers for him. So when he came to visit me, he would have food. And on the topic of food, we also make a special bread that only gets made, sweet bread that only gets made during the months of October and the first month of November, which is called pan de muertos. It's particularly delicious, and it's just very famous in our culture. Many people are just waiting for October because they can buy the bread. And then another one of the biggest themes and pieces of an altar or ofrenda is the cempasúchil flower, or marigold as it is known. In Mexico, it is purely cultivated for this purpose, for this holiday. Any point throughout the year, if you're trying to find this flower in a market or any place like that, you won't be able to find it, because technically it's not supposed to be cultivated if it's not specifically for Day of the Dead celebrations. And the importance of the patchouli flower is like a beacon. The significance of having patchouli flowers in ofrenda, it's you're supposed to lay them out on the floor. You're supposed to lay down a path from the outside of your house, from the street, into the ofrenda, because it's a beacon for your loved one to find you. That way they can find their way home. They can find a path. It's one of the elements that's used in that aspect, as well as the candles, the element of fire that is also used to let your loved ones know where you are in case you moved or you live somewhere else from the last time that they were with you. And now different types of ofrendas. Now, we're speaking right now about traditional ofrendas because anybody can make any type of ofrenda. You can interpret it and put your own ideas into it because, you know, the basic idea of ofrenda is honoring a loved one who's passed away. So traditionally speaking right now, we're going to talk about three different types of altars, but, you know, any type of altar in which you're dedicating to a loved one is also very acceptable. So we have a altar of two levels, an altar of three, and an altar of seven. So the two-level one. They represent the division between earth and heaven. It's pretty simple. It's basic. And again, we see more of the religious faith that the conquistadors brought in, now fully engulfed into the celebration. Three-level altars. They represent heaven, earth, and purgatory. Again, simple. I would say this is the most popular one that gets made often. And right now I'm going to take a little pause in this slide to describe some of the more important basic elements of an altar, or ofrenda, as it's known in Spanish. We have the four basic elements, which is earth, wind, water, and fire. Those have to be represented in the ofrenda. Now we use papel picado, the colorful paper with holes that makes a beautiful design. That represents air, wind. We usually have a glass of water. We usually have a glass of salt or even dirt to represent earth, and fire are candles, which, as I mentioned before, also serve as a beacon for our loved ones to know where to visit and who to visit. And not as traditionally, but now it's been several years that the calaveritas, the little skulls, which represent pretty much the person that you are honoring in their death, because you always put a picture of what they look like when they were alive. But now these calaveritas, these little sugar skulls, which you decorate, and then on the forehead, you can put the name of your loved one. So it's just another way of recognizing them and paying tribute to them. Now the seven level altar, these are fairly complicated and usually typically find them outside of churches. And so I'll go through the levels real quick. And these levels aren't necessarily representative of like heaven, hell, and purgatory as in the previous examples. But here is more, each level contains certain items. For example, first level, which would be the one at the top. So we're going from the top to the bottom. A picture of a saint or a virgin. It's dedicated to the souls in purgatory, the second level. So there, that's where you would put somebody that you would think is in purgatory, or you would just put food. The third level, salt is set as a symbol of purification of the souls. Four, bread is offered as food for the souls, as we previously mentioned. And the fifth level, the favorite food and drink of the whoever the altar is being dedicated to. The pictures of those being honored. And lastly, a cross formed from flowers or fruit is set at ground level. This, instead of displaying a lot of flowers and patchouli flowers on the floor, well, you display a cross of flowers and fruits on the floor. Now, just some examples of other ways of celebrating Day of the Dead, because it's not just about building an ofrenda. But there's also several events, very powerful and important events that happen in Mexico throughout the celebration. And one of these places in the state of Morelos called Pátzcuaro, which is one of the most emotive Day of the Dead celebrations. People fill cemeteries. They actually go to where their loved ones are buried, and they light up the outline of the graves, the actual graves, and they sit there and they bring all the elements of an ofrenda to the cemetery. Every single one of the elements, they play music and they pretty much have fun and they throw a party celebrating their loved ones with their actual physical remains. It's a jaw-dropping experience. If anyone has a chance to ever get to do it, I highly recommend it. And then Xochimilco in the Chinampas in Mexico City. This is at the southern most part of Mexico City. And this part of Mexico City is the last example of how things look like when the conquistadors arrived and actually when the Mesoamerican civilizations actually built the city, built their cities, because they built them on top of water, which are the chinampas, which is the technique of grabbing dirt and soil and dumping it in the water to create a platform, to create like a pyramid underwater, a platform where then you can build on top of it. And this city in Xochimilco is still like that to this day. It's kind of like a Venice type of situation where the few locals that still live there have to travel on boats from their houses to anywhere they want to go. And it's become a huge tourist attraction in Mexico. The boats, they get decorated and very vibrant colors, Day of the Dead, and people go have fun there. And well, it's a historical site because it's pretty much as it can be, it hasn't been changed since Mesoamerican times. And finally, lastly, the parade in downtown Mexico City. Culturally, Day of the Dead has evolved so much that it was a centerpiece in the movie for James Bond, which I will show in the next slide, actually. And they, in order to make this movie happen in downtown Mexico, they actually requested Mexico City to make a parade. Mexico City never had a parade of Day of the Dead before. It's not something that happened. As I said, the celebrations are usually personal at home, or you go to a cemetery and to pay respects for your loved ones. But in this case, just to make this movie happen, and because, you know, they wanted James Bond to be wearing a Day of the Dead mask, they created this parade. And ever since then, it's been the biggest parade in Mexico City. People dress up, they celebrate. Now they found a way to more modernly, I would say, with these times, celebrate the Day of the Dead, but more in a party festival type of scene. And then we have Mega Altars exhibition of UNAM, the University of Mexico. These are just gigantic altar exhibitions where they create giant Katrinas, giant type of monsters, you could say. And it's just a really great exhibition there at the university where people can see literally giant altars, giant cempasúchil flowers, giant crosses, giant Day of the Dead bread, all kinds of things, but everything in a giant scale. And as I, to close up, we started the beginning of this with how the Mesoamerican culture, how they believed in the afterlife and several different gods, depending on how you passed away, was the place that you went to. And then with the conquistadors, everything changed. It got blended in. And then we got the Day of the Dead, which as you can tell, you can be celebrated by ofrendas, by going to the cemetery, and now more modernly, parties, festivals, and pop culture. They make movies, a movie Coco, you know, they make a award-winning, hit-winning film that is derived around Day of the Dead. And with that, yes, that will be all.
Well, thanks, Marlon, for that. That's really interesting. It's really cool to hear how there are so many elements that are that have been retained since Mesoamerican celebrations, and how it's still evolving today. And I wonder too if that's, you know, if some of that is unwanted, like with all of the pop culture media. I know it's, especially when we do exhibitions like this, you know, in the United States, it's, we want to be very careful not to have any kind of cultural appropriation. And so I'm curious, just a quick question for you, if you see things like Coco and Spectre as like beneficial, or if you think it's detracting at all, or if it's, you know, as in the world, it's, you know, there's good things and bad things from it as well.
I think it's a very good question. I think it does have a bit of both, but our posture here at the consulate when it comes to culture is that we want everybody to know about our culture. We want everyone to understand why we do things. And so in that aspect, I think it's really good for people to find out what the Day of the Dead is about. Yeah. And we also think it's really good for people to make their own interpretations about it, because at the end of the day, it's a personal holiday. You decide how you're going to honor your loved ones. So, for example, if you don't want to make an altar that's 100% traditional, that's completely fine, because you're still making one. You're still making an ofrenda, and that's what this celebrates. That's what this is about. That in our culture, we celebrate our loved ones who passed away. We celebrate them, and after a period of mourning, of course.
Yeah, and for me personally, because I've been working on this exhibition for, I think, 7 years now, and, you know, I had heard about the holiday, but I had never practiced it. I've never really known it intimately. And since I've started, actually, you know, we at my family home, we put together an altar, and my husband's mother passed away when my daughter was very young, and she still has stories that she can tell about her Nana, who she doesn't really remember. But because every year we come together and we talk about and we celebrate, we have stories, we make favorite, you know, we make her favorite dish. And so, like, that for me is just amazing. And I can't imagine, you know, having grown up with that for generations, and how long those stories can continue. So for me, that's the personal experience that I've had with it. And I appreciate all of you from the Mexican consulate helping with the DIA put an exhibition like this together that can share the Mexican culture and also make bridges between all sorts of cultures that we find here in Southeast Michigan. So thank you. So now we're actually going to go and we're going to talk about some of the altars that you can see in the exhibition this year. And Marlon, you helped put together an altar with other members of the Mexican consulate. So if you wanted to go ahead and start talking about your altar, let us know who it's honoring, some of the elements that you see in here, and reasons why that you chose to use those elements. And as you can see too, this is the image on screen. This is our online walkthrough. It's a lot like Google Maps. You can kind of move around, you can zoom in. So as you talk, I'll just kind of highlight some of the elements that you're talking about.
Yes, of course. Thank you, Emily. So this year we decided to do our honor of Vicente Fernandez, who passed away of December of last year. We'll make a quick note. Usually this isn't like a rule or anything, but typically sometimes you would have to wait a year after somebody passed away in order to make an ofrenda. And technically this would not be a year, because it's a year would be in December 12th, I believe he passed away. So we had, first of all, we made contact with his wife and his son Gerardo to make sure it was okay, that they wouldn't have a problem with this. And yes, they said it was fine. They would love for us to honor him. So with that, we moved forward. And first, I'd like to thank and recognize the team here at the consulate, Claudia Rodriguez, Jesus Gutierrez, Jose Luis Figueroa, and Abel Gomez, who helped and design and build this beautiful ofrenda. And so this honors Vicente Fernandez. We called it Chente Fernandez. Chente was one of his many nicknames. He was an extremely popular, doesn't quite cover the type of artist he was, of Mexican music, of ranchera music in particular. I grew up listening to, like, classic American rock, that's what my father liked, and I still know the majority of his songs. He is an extremely popular figure in Mexican music. And here in Mexico, in actually in Salvador de Story, our Mexican population happens to be from Jalisco, from the state of Jalisco, Guadalajara, which is from where Vicente Fernandez is from. So we knew this would have a big cultural impact in our Mexican population, also our Latino population, Hispanic population, because we know he's also very popular, you know, with people that listen to Mexican music. And that's who and why we decided to do it. Some of the specific pieces that we decided to include, first of all, would be the original authentic charro suit. That charro suit was made in 1957, I believe. And it's completely authentic, original. It's been handed down two generations. It was made in Mexico City. And more importantly, it's the exact replica of one that Vicente Fernandez wore when he was just starting his career. So we're very proud to have that piece. And we also have a guitar, you know, just because he was a singer with a guitar. We have a lot of the, and then as you can see there, we have the horseshoe. He had a ranch in Guadalajara, and he was also very famous for having horses and having a ranch. So we decided, oh, well, you know, this is pretty much like his ranch entrance this way. If Vicente Fernandez would like to go to the DIA to visit his ofrenda, he could see his little ranch entrance and he would be familiar with it. That's a, you know, just a little thing that we decided to put there in reference to him and his family. And we have all the basic traditional elements. We have our flowers, we have our papel picado, we have incense, we have el carbón, which is what you burn the incense with, the cup exactly right there. We have a bunch of calaveritas, candles, food, the bread, you know, a lot of the basic elements. And one of the elements that we're particularly proud of is a music box right in the middle, right there. It's motion censored. So as soon as visitors get close to the limit of where the string is, where you can't get any closer anymore, it'll activate it. And for 15 seconds, 20 seconds, I believe, it'll play three different songs of his that are very popular, very segments, which we believe add a little bit extra to the ofrenda, and people can actually hear some of his music because, you know, that's why he was loved so much, because of the work that he did.
Yeah, that's great. When I go through, I change the batteries on the candles every, like every 2 days, and I always get to hear it. So it's really great to hear. And I actually I went online to YouTube because I was not familiar with him, and I started listening to a lot of his songs. So it was nice to make that new discovery for me. So, and I hope others feel the same way. Well, thank you very much for talking about your piece. And I think now we're going to move over to another artist, Megan Nalani, right? So just the same like Marlon did, if you could just tell us about your piece, who it honors, why you chose some of the elements that you did, if you have a history with Day of the Dead, if not, when did you first start learning about it, and all those kinds of things.
This is from my dad. We're both artists, and he we used to go to the DIA, the Ofrenda exhibit, all the time, and we always went to the DIA together. That was kind of our thing. He would take me to, like, different art exhibits all over, you know, all over the city, and especially to the DIA. So I just thought it'd be cool to honor him and put, like, a few examples of his art in the DIA. I think that he would enjoy that. And I just thought this would be, like, a nice way to process that, and just a really beautiful way to just pay tribute to him, because he really loved art and we just love coming to this exhibit. So yeah. I added, you'll see right there, like an example of his workspace, you know, like a little work table with all of his art supplies and little examples of his artwork and pictures of him and his art around the city. He, you know, did a lot of stuff in the Eastern Market, the Germac signs and the Hurt company. He always did all their signs and their vans, and on the other side, he really liked to travel and go out west, and he loved Yellowstone. His brother works out in Yellowstone. He'd always want to go visit his brother there, and traveling was a huge thing for him, just always going on road trips and, you know, riding horses out west. So just wanted to incorporate that. And then,
yeah, there's so many elements here. You could look at this for hours and not see them all, I feel.
Yeah, it's kind of like into the Virgin Suicide version of making And then, you know, he was a pinstriper, so I added that card on there and some of his pinstriping art supplies. And then he's really into music, so I added the record, like Blues and Kinks, and so I added some of those records there. And then a lot of flowers to incorporate, you know, Day of the Dead. And he was Catholic and really into his faith, so I added like the Virgin Mary, and that's part of the Dia de los Muertos traditions. And was really into reading, so I was very literate, so I added all the different books that he was inspired by. And you know, towards the top it's like a lot of stars because he was into astronomy and geology and different sciences and stuff like that. And you know, before he passed, he always talked about going out west again, like taking a horse, riding out west. And then afterwards, my daughter, she's 4 years old, she kept saying that she sees him in dreams, and he keeps telling her that he rode out to the stars. So that's why I did the staircase, so he could go up to the stars and ride the horse up to the stars. And that was kind of like a thing. He would come in dreams and tell me he's up in the stars. He can come down whenever he wants, but he's up in the stars. So that's why I kind of wanted to do like the double helix, and it goes from green to purple, so like earth up to night sky. So it just kind of incorporates, it could have been like a Stairway to Heaven, but he really likes that song, I Talked to the Wind by King Crimson. So I was trying to do like a double helix up to the stars, and so it's just kind of his journey up from earth bound up to, that's why I put the religious statues up towards the top, near the stars and the telescope and the little crystals there. So it's more like a spiritual journey up towards the stars on his horse. So that's kind of why I did that. And all those things, since he's very Catholic and really into, you know, plants and flowers, and just added some of the things that he loved in that way, like it's not appropriating, like I feel like that's how it kind of honors the Dia de los Muertos traditions.
It is beautiful and just layered in meaning, Megan. So thank you so much for sharing some of your father's story and creating such a beautiful altar to put in the exhibition.
Thank you. I'm glad to be able to participate in this.
Okay. Now we're going to jump over to our next room. Sorry if it's a little jumpy here. And we're going to talk with Adriana about her piece, Pre-Hispanic Ofrenda.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adriana Carrera. I'm an architecture student from Commerce Township with Mexican roots, and I'm also a member of the Ballet Folklorico Mexico Lindo, who sponsored this ofrenda. I'm the artist of the Pre-Hispanic Ofrenda, and I chose to showcase Aztec traditions for this ofrenda because of the connection between pre-Hispanic traditions for Dia de Muertos and how those traditions influenced current traditions that are now used for Dia de Muertos. Another reason why I chose to showcase Aztec traditions is because of the unique design of the ofrenda. My pre-Hispanic ofrenda is inspired by Aztec offerings. These offerings would consist of fruit, flowers, seeds, incense, and many more items. And usually in the middle of these offerings, there would be an image of the god of death, Mictlantecuhtli. And Mictlantecuhtli's name translates to the Lord of the Land of the Dead. And because he was such an important figure in the Aztec afterlife, this image was placed in the center. And another element to the pre-Hispanic ofrendas were the xoloitzcuintles, or the Mexican hairless dogs, which you can see in the corner. These were often sacrificed and buried with their owners because they were believed to guide souls to Mictlan, the Aztec underworld. And because Mictlan is the realm which the Aztec god of death rules over, these dogs were also an important figure. and they were seen as a symbol of the Aztec god of death. The Aztec people believed that the souls of the dead traveled for years to reach Mictlan, and because it was a dangerous journey to travel through the realms of the underworld, there was an occasion where once a year, the souls would receive help from the living, hence the offerings. The living would place items such as fruits, flowers, seeds, incense, to help guide the souls to Mictlan. And you can see some of these traditions, these pre-Hispanic traditions, tie into current Dia de Muertos traditions, and how it's blended with Catholic tradition to become what is now known as Dia de Muertos. These offerings would be placed around tombs to help guide the souls to Mictlan. And nowadays, you can see that is also a relevant part of Dia de Muertos offerings. While they may not look exactly like pre-Hispanic offerings, offerings are placed next to the tombs of the dead to guide the souls, essentially. The process of making this ofrenda was a very long and tedious process. As you can see, the centerpiece of the ofrenda is made of seeds, grains, and rice. And the process consisted of gluing down each individual seed and grain to create this image of the Aztec god of death. And the ofrenda also includes a video that cannot be showcased because of the online format, but I recommend if you go in person to check it out.
I might be able to play a little clip if you want me to.
Okay, yes, that would be great.
It might be just small. I don't know. Let's see how the sound goes. Oh, maybe it won't load. Well, if you visit the digital exhibition, when you click on the label here, the video will just play. But you can also click on and actually view it on YouTube, or you can come and see it in person. So there is a quick teaser, let's say.
Yes. Yeah, that video features Aztec dances from some of the dancers of the Ballet Folklorico Mexico Lindo. The dancers, Sandra Navarro, Yasmina Petris, and Amanda Carrera. These dancers performed a couple Aztec dances to accompany the ofrenda. And in general, my ofrenda is a take on the representation of a pre-Hispanic ofrenda that would be made during the pre-Hispanic times. This ofrenda aims to showcase Aztec traditions and how these traditions have influenced traditions that are used now for Dia de Muertos. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ariana, for sharing. I have to say, I was so impressed you came with this board. Everything was already completed. And I think you glued it down because of our requirements, right? So, and correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is that these would typically be the designs would be done loosely. And is it typically, would it have normally been like a community aspect, or would it just have been like one person doing the design? Or
yeah, so these seeds are all glued down for the sake of making it easier to transport. But yeah, usually they would all be placed on site, no glue used, just making all the designs freehand. And usually, yeah, it'd be a collaborative effort and to make these ofrendas.
Yeah, it's just beautiful. The design here in the middle, there's just so much details with all the different types of seeds. And it's really great that you can, you know, like I said before, and Marlon said before, like there are so many elements that have been retained since the Mesoamerica, and it's still, you see it in modern day interpretations, which is, it's great to retain that history. So thank you so much for sharing. And now we will move to the next room again. and we're going to talk with another one of our partners, Stephanie Pena and Georgina Garcia, who are with Mexican Town CDC. They designed and built this piece. So Stephanie and Georgina.
Yes. Hi. So like you mentioned, Georgina and I, we represent Mexican Town Community Development Corporation, and we're located here in Southwest Detroit off of Bagley Street. And the ofrenda that we made this year is titled El Viaje de las Mariposas Monarcas, which translates to the journey of the monarch butterflies. And we're paying homage to immigrants who have located in the Metro Detroit area. So you'll notice it's similar sort of off of what Marlon presented earlier, is that our structure is a tiered structure. It's not quite seven levels, it's about three. And we have an archway of flowers at the top and some elements on the ground to sort of represent that pathway. But in choosing to honor immigrants that have settled in the city of Detroit and the broader metro area, we really wanted to engage the community in determining who was going to be on our altar. So we were able to do a lot of outreach and get photos from the community. And similar to other altars, combine that with candles and recuerdos, which are essentially little tokens of memories, whether it be a candle representing the patron saint of San Julitas, or be a bottle of Coke or a bottle of tequila. We have all those elements sort of intricately placed next to these individuals who the community wanted to honor this year. I think one of our favorite elements, and it's in the title of our ofrenda that we incorporated this year, were the monarch butterflies, which Georgina is going to speak about.
Yes, just briefly, the monarch butterflies are very significant during the Dia de Muertos because they visit us during, they represent the souls of our deceased loved ones during this important festivity. And we decided, because they represent, they do the same journey as the immigrants to the South and Central and North America, and it coincides with this time of the year. So that's why, even though they are small butterflies, they also represent immigrants that are not the ones that are lost in the path of the journey to make a better life here in the United States. And some of the immigrants, the pictures of the immigrants that you can see there, are grandparents, are fathers who moved to Detroit for to work in the automotive industry. Others are workers in the agriculture. That's why we have some dry grass elements in the ofrenda as well. And the sundust, we have a little bit of it on the ground to symbolize the, as Stephanie mentioned it, the pathway as well. And the infinity symbol, because as we remember our deceased loved ones every year, they are gonna be with us always, right? Forever.
Yeah, so our process, so we took the time over the summer to create this, and Georgina and I had the privilege of creating an altar together for the first time last year with the opening of MCDC's gallery space, which we're really excited to have the opportunity to go to the DIA this year. But during the time, I was actually in the Rio Grande Valley in Texas. So we're talking a borderland community in southern Texas while Georgina was here in Detroit. And we were able to combine elements, Georgina being from Mexico City, mm-hmm. and our executive director being, his family being from Mexico too, being able to combine elements that they've accumulated through their journeys through Mexico over their lifetime, in conjunction with me being able to gather items from the borderlands of Texas, where a lot of immigrants have come up to and from to Michigan, really facilitated the everything that you see in front of you in this altar. So a lot of these pieces have meanings to each of our respective families.
Awesome. Yeah, it's so beautiful. It's really nice to hear this idea about the infinity sign. I didn't even make that connection. So it's really great that you're able to come today. That's a really beautiful sentiment. And there are, again, so many details here. All of these little, what was the term that you used for the little mementos, the little objects?
Recuerdos.
Recuerdos.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's there's so many. This piece is just really beautiful to look at. So once again, thank you so much. Thank you for being a partner on this exhibition. The DIA would not be able to do this exhibition as well as it does without the contributions of our community partners.
Thank you for the invitation as well.
Yeah. Okay, and so we'll go to the last altar that we're going to speak about today. We have Diane Gomez Burden and Cheryl Geitman doing Good Morning, Mother Earth.
Hello, thank you for having us. My mom is joining remotely just to listen in, but I could not have done this without her. So the piece is focused on murdered environmentalists of Central Latin America. According to some news sources, Central America is the most dangerous place for environmentalists. Generally what happens is they become vocal against logging, against deforestation, against the relocation of water sources, and then politicians, people in power tend to get them out of the way. And it's very tragic. So the piece is dedicated to all of those. And in looking for who I should put pictures of up, it was disturbingly difficult to choose because there are so many to choose from. But what I ended up doing was just kind of looking through all the names of people that had been murdered over the last 10 years or so, and just found people that really connected to me that I thought, you know, I could learn a lot about. First of all, there was information about them and the ones that I just felt connected to. So in this altar is from left to right, Aiden, Lyra, Berta Flores, Homero Gonzalez, Yugi Martinez, Paulina Escudero, and Oscar Adams. And they were all advocates of either, Homero Gonzalez was actually the person who really inspired this because I had heard about his murder. And he was an advocate for monarch butterflies. And I heard about that on the news over a year ago. And it really resonated with me. I'm like, how could you murder somebody who's advocating for butterflies? And so he kind of inspired the whole thing. And all these people were just very cool individuals whose time came too soon. So that's who this piece is in honor of. Unfortunately, you know, I don't know these people, so I wasn't really sure what they liked. And I did some research, but I figured since I don't know what kind of food or drink they would have late at night, that I could at least just represent their passions. So that's the trees, the little critters, the water is represented on the bottom. And then the other thing that I didn't do a good job explaining in my artist statement, but the entire thing is made out of recycled material. So it's just a bunch of like paper towels and like plastic wrappers and metal that I found on the sidewalk and vacant lots. And I raided my mother-in-law's garage, her barn. I reached out to my community, my friends, my family, my coworkers at City Year. They were awesome helps, and I used almost everything they gave me. So there's t-shirts that, you know, our kids aren't wearing anymore. There's egg cartons, there's ramen noodle bags, like the water is all t-shirts and pillowcases that people gave me. So I didn't really buy anything for this. The entire thing is kind of just scrapped together. And I thought that, you know, our environmental protectors would appreciate that, or at least, you know, see it and understand it. So when it comes to like the actual altar, I was reminded of the book, The Great Kapok Tree by Lynn Cherry. It was a book my mom gave me. She's my influence in all things. She's an artist. She helped me with this. I could not have done it without her. She was the first person I called when I saw this opportunity. I said, Mom, you've got to help me with this. I want to do it, and I can't do it without you. But she gave me that book when I was really little, and it's about a man who walks into the forest to cut down a tree, falls asleep, and critters of the forest come to him and convince him not to, and he wakes up and walks away. So there's the snake in the tree. There's the little critters on the bottom. There's the butterflies. The butterflies, as we just heard, are very symbolic when it comes to ofrendas and helping people get to their families. And so I wanted to include that. The critters are really for Yugi. He was a 20-year-old who had decided to spend the COVID quarantine with his parents on their ranch or at his parents' ranch to do research, and he was found murdered. He was only 20 years old, but he was obsessed with little critters. And it's interesting because he's younger, you can see lots of his social media pictures, and I just thought that he would have appreciated the little recycled critters on there. That's pretty much it. It was a lot of collecting stuff and just figuring out how to make it work.
Yeah. Well, you've done a beautiful job in honoring these folks who have, you know, they offered their lives to try to protect our planet. And some of the details that you see here are really cool. Like your snake, your water bottle snake, just made out of water bottles. It's so hidden. Like you really have to look, and then you have to think, I know what that shape is. Oh, it's water bottles. And then I don't know if I'm going to be able to show it here. Once you enter this room, if you come in person, as soon as you enter your room, if you look at it, you get this overall shape of a skull, which I think is just kind of you've got the images here, the teeth of the skull and the wings or the eyes and the trees make the outline. And it's just it's a really striking image when you move into that room, and it just draws you in. And then all of the little things just draw you in even further. It's a really beautiful piece of art. And like Marlone said in the beginning, that, you know, altars, there are some specific elements, the most important being which that it honors someone who has passed away, and that you can kind of use your own interpretation to go with it. So thank you so much for participating. This is a beautiful piece, and a sad reason to do it, but a beautiful piece.
Thank you.
Okay. So now I think we're going to invite all of the artists back onto the screen. And if there are any questions from the audiences, I think there have been some chats coming through. I'm not sure if any of them are specific questions. But I can have a couple of questions just in general, but we're also close to time. I guess one of the questions that I always like to ask the artists that I've worked with over the years, and it relates to kind of the story that I related earlier of how, you know, I've been able to use my experience with this exhibition in my personal life, and it's helped me remember stories of, it's helped myself and my daughter remember stories of past loved ones. And one of the artists many years ago said that she knew the recipe of her great-great-grandmother's favorite dish because of Day of the Dead. And so for those of you on here who have practiced Day of the Dead throughout your life, if there's anything in particular that stands out to you, a story that you know only because you have Day of the Dead, if there's anything that you want to tell us along those lines, I love to hear those stories.
I mean, I can jump in, I guess. Okay. Yeah. I actually didn't really celebrate this at all historically. I'm half Mexican, but very much white. And so now that I have children of my own, both their grandparents, their grandfathers are dead. And it's something that we started to do because they'll never know my dad or my husband's dad, and I would love them to know them more. So even the way Megan was talking about the dreams and the staircases, like, I really hope that my kids can know their grandpas. And it's kind of just a way for me to reconnect with my cultural heritage, which I feel like has kind of been stripped away from me from colonialism and society and all of that. So that's my experience with it.
Thank you. Anyone else have any comments in that vein?
I just want to comment about the people from the community of people from Metro Detroit that send us the pictures of their deceased loved ones or defuntos. They are very grateful for this opportunity. And so they went already to the DIA to see the ofrenda and again, send us messages again, thanking us for that. It means a lot to them, and that they are sure that their grandparents or their father will love this homenaje to them, to this ofrenda. And yes, as a Mexican, I feel very grateful for this
tradition that we have in Mexico that goes back, and it's a way to connect with our deceased loved ones. Like for my father, I set up a very simple offering at home, but to me, it's a way to reconnect to him, to my grandma, to my grandparents that I didn't meet. So it's very enriched, yeah, beautiful experience.
Okay, well, I think that puts us at an end. I want to thank again all of our artists. Oh, yep. I want to thank all of our artists who participated today and all of the artists who participated in the exhibition. We focused on 5 altars today, but there are 14 in total. So once again, if you can, there's 1 more week. It closes Sunday, November 6th. If you could come on down to the DIA and see in person, it is free with museum admission. And if you are a resident of Wayne, Oakland, and Macomb County, the museum admission is free. So please come on down and check it out. If you're not able to come down, we do hope that you can go to our website, dia.org/ofrendas2022, and then you can go through the digital exhibition that you were seeing us use earlier throughout the show. And then I want to thank my colleagues who run the Thursdays at the Museum program for allowing us to use this platform as a way to get a little bit more information out there from these artists. And if you did enjoy watching this, we do have programs every Thursday online. And Sharon will come back to let you know what's coming up next week and in the future.
Thank you. That was a wonderful presentation. I want to thank Emily for offering such an enlightening program and all the artists involved. And here's a treat. If you're interested in helping create an ofrenda, you can do so by joining us for a workshop at the Lorenzo Cultural Center on Saturday in Clinton Township, where you're invited to contribute to a community ofrenda that will be dedicated to the people and the things lost during the COVID pandemic. For more information and to register for that, please visit the Lorenzo Cultural Center's website at the link that's shared in the chat. So look in the chat for the link to the Lorenzo Center if you want to contribute to a community ofrenda. And please join us here next Thursday at 1 p.m. for our studio visit with the artist Katie Bramlage. Thank you. Have a great weekend.